Hello guys.
Hi.
Nice to see you people. And today's topic is the concept of social influence. Our objectives for today will be defining social influence, differentiate between the various types of social influence, analyze various factors associated with conformity, and explain various factors affecting the compliance, as well as describing the factors affecting obedience. As we said, we're going to first define social influence. What exactly is social influence? Social influence is any change in an individual's thoughts, feelings, or behaviors caused by another person who is actually present, who may be actually present, or their presence is imagined. So the way you behave generally changes when you're alone and when you are around people. Suppose say you're eating Maggie at home. If it falls right in front of your shirt also, you'll pick it up and eat it. But if you're at a party or in a public place, and a place where other people, or where you think that someone else is watching you or can watch you, you tend to be very dignified with the way you're eating or the way you're sitting, the way you're dressed and everything, right? That is social influence, the influence that the other person who's either present or assumed to be present has on the way you behave, the thoughts that you have and the feelings that you have is social influence. So social influence is the interpersonal process that can cause individuals to change their thought, feeling and behavior. So the current trends on social influence. Social influence can also be defined as a process by which an individual makes changes to their thoughts and behaviors as a result of interaction with others who are perceived to be similar, desirable, or experts. So it also depends on who you are with or who you're in the presence of, right? So if someone is similar to you, you'll behave in a different way. If there's someone you desire in the sense, it doesn't have to be, in a very intimate way or something. It can be either spiritually, intellectually, or, the other way is around. So how you behave in front of someone who you're attracted to or who you want to meet or something also differs. And again, the way you behave in front of an expert. You can't go boasting around in front of an expert saying that, oh, I know everything about this. The person will laugh and say you're stupid. That's it, right? So you'll have to behave like as if you don't know anything. You can try to discuss with this person in order to get information, but you shouldn't behave like as though you know all of it, right? That is how you behave. This is what social influence is. People adjust their beliefs with respect to others to whom they feel similar in accordance with psychological principles such as balance. Individuals are also influenced by the majority. When a large portion of an individual's referent group, a referent social group, holds a particular attitude, it is likely that the individual will adapt to it, right? So when there's a huge majority, and this person is in that majority. Like suppose say there's a huge group of 20 people, 30 people or something. This person alone thinks that they should do this work X, but the rest of them are like, no, we're supposed to do the work Y before we can do X. Then he'll have to comply to that, right? That person has to comply to the fact that he has to do Y before X. He can't go against the group, right? That is what influences, how an individual is influenced by majority. Change in opinion under influence of an other who is perceived to be an expert in the matter of hand. So again, you're influenced by someone who knows more than you in a particular topic. Suppose you take something like cooking. You would, when you are talking about cooking, some people say when you're frying onions, you're not supposed to add salt. But majority of the experts say that if you add salt to onions while cooking it, it fries it faster. It helps the onions sweat faster and hence automatically helps it fry faster. This is what the experts say. So you'll obviously listen to the expert more than you listen to whatever the minority tells you, right? Any questions till now? Apparently not. Okay. Okay, thank you. So these guys, French and Raven, in the year 1959, viewed social influence as the outcome of the exertion of social powers from one of the five bases. According to our textbook, there are only five powers, but according to the internet, there are six. Okay, so today I will talk about the sixth one as well. So the five powers that are mentioned in our textbook are reward power, coercive power, legitimate power, referent power, right? Apart from this, there's another power called the information power or informative power. Okay. And let's look at each one individually. Okay. I don't think this was found in the textbook. And let's discuss each one, right? What is reward power? Reward power is the ability to give rewards when other people comply to their wishes. So suppose there's a boss and there are his employees. So when a boss cracks a joke and people, his employees laugh at it, they're laughing at it because it is something that is expected of them, right? Because of their laughter, the boss might reward them with something even though the joke is very bad. So suppose say they're in a party or something, the boss and his employee are talking to one of the boss's neighbor and the boss cracks a very bad joke. The employee laughs at it because he knows that if he doesn't, then the power, that reward power that the boss has is not going to give him any benefit. If he laughs, there is a chance that the boss might feel happy enough to give him a reward. That is your reward power. Coercive power is the complete opposite of your reward power. When reward power is talking about giving rewards, coercive power is talking about giving out punishments. It is the ability to deliver punishments while it has, this has a short-term effect. Sorry. It is the ability to give out punishments, right? This particular power is very short-term. Its effect is very short-term. So once you give a punishment to someone, they'll take the punishment, they'll do what they have to do in the punishment, and then they'll be like, ignore it. Right. And it is also a very wrong type of a power because it puts stress on the bond that you have with another person, be it your employer-employee relationship, be it your mother-father relationship or your mother-daughter relationship, any sort of a relationship. If it has a coercive power working on it, there is going to be a problem in the relationship. There is not going to be a bond that is well settled, right? Let's move on to the next power, that is your legitimate power. Legitimate power is the power that you get due to a position or a role. So here, the role actually plays a much more important role. A role may have much more importance than the individual. So a position may have much more importance than an individual who is in it, right? So suppose say the prime minister of a country, the person changes, but the title, the prime minister has the power in it, right? Only the prime minister can give certain rules and regulations that has to be followed by the rest of the country. If the person in the position is strong on their own, if they have expert power and expert power and reward power, they actually tend to increase the power of the legitimate power or the capacity of the legitimate power. For example, I know this is controversial. Many people might not think of it. People like Barack Obama and Modi, all these people have legitimate power as well as power that is not amongst all this. They have informational power, expert power, and legitimate power, which makes the world a better place. Expert power, again, is the power that refers to people who have knowledge, right? The term knowledge is power is what it is, this entire expert power. Expert power is where your expertise or knowledge is the source of your power. And I don't think that that needs further explanation. Then we have referent power. Referent power here is where a role model comes into play. This is the power that one possesses that makes other people want to be like him or want to be like them. For example, as I said, role models. People following this person find them attractive in some way or another, and they start to mimic or model their behavior or thinking. A referent power can also be of a group, a social group, right? It doesn't have to be of an individual. It can be also of a group. Then we have your last and final power, which is your informational power. Informational power is, again, a transitory type of a power. Once you give away an information that you have, the power is lost along with the words, right? Suppose, say, you have a secret that you're keeping on another person. This person has done something bad and you have a secret hidden within you. You can use that in order to control that person. I know this is a very bad example, but still, it is what happens in movies and TV shows and all that, right? A secret that you know of another person, you can use it to control this other person. The minute you give away the secret to someone else or the person who you're having control over, the whole power that you have on this person or on the secret or on the information is lost. That is what informational power is. Okay, here information about the content of a specific situation holds the power.
Can you explain the second one, coercive power?
Coercive power is the power to give punishments. So a teacher has two types of power, multiple types of power, in fact, but I'll talk about the major two. Your reward power is to give appreciations and rewards to this particular person. However, your coercive power is where you're punished. The teacher gives out punishments, right? She's delivering punishments. It is the power through which the teacher can get the child to do something even though he or she doesn't want to do it. With the fear of punishment, the child does it, right? That is coercion. Did you get it?
Yeah, I understood.
Okay. Thank you so much. Now, the six types of powers, right? They can be used in different ways. But I will give you small uses of these types of powers. So the next time you're in a group, right? You're in a group or you're trying to follow a particular group or an individual, try to find out where this person's power is coming from. Is it being rewarding power, coercive power, legitimate power, expert power, referent power, or informational power? Okay. And where the power comes from is important for you to find your role models as well. Okay. If it is coming from expert power or informational power, very good. Reward power, excellent. But the rest of them is a little on the iffy side, right? If you're in a position of leadership, when you are in a position of leadership, make sure that you practice self-awareness and know what where you draw your powers from and your influence from. So your power has to be, again, a part of your expert power, referent power, and your rewarding power. These are your strongholds. And the next one is, if you hold information and think it gives you power, remember that informational power is very fragile. It is very fragile base. The minute you give away the information, the power that you hold is lost. Legitimate power comes and goes with the position, and informational power is very fleeting. So the best kind of power that you can have is expert power and reward power. These are the firm and worthy ways to improve your influence And rewards can be as simple as appreciating someone and acknowledging the work someone does. So this is how you can use all the powers that you have. We will move on and come back to the topic at hand, right? So in case of a change in opinion or attitude, it was considered an instance of social influence, right? So suppose, say, so I'll take the topic of child marriage and sati. So till then, it was of a popular opinion that child marriage and sati were awesome. But when people who came in to reform all these practices came in, it was a social instance of social influence, because they took a lot of effort in changing the opinions and attitudes of sati and child marriage. If you take Ambedkar, your B.R. Ambedkar, the way he changed the attitude and opinion towards these ST and SC caste people was revolutionary. It was an instance of social influence. Scholars have distinguished true social influence from forced public acceptance and from changes based on reward and coercive power. So scholars have found out what true social influence is, and they found out what forced public acceptance was. So sati was actually a forced public acceptance, right? It was a rule that was there till then. And from that, changes were made with the help of coercive and reward powers. Researchers are still concerned with topics like public compliance, reward power, and coercive power. These concerns are differentiated from influence studies. Current research on social influence generally uses experimental methodology and tends to fall in five main categories. So the current research in social influence, which are falling into these five categories, are minority influence in group settings, research in persuasion, dynamic social impact theory, a structural approach to social influence and expectation state theory. So what is minority influence? Minority influence is the social pressure exerted on the majority of the group by a smaller faction of the group. Now, taking SE and ST itself, and again, controversial topics, at the time of formation of our constitution, it was said that for 10 years, there should be a reservation for SC and ST. But there was some loophole through which it has been extended till date, right? So the minority group was pressured by these smaller groups, that is SC and ST, in order to extend their reservations that they had, right? The right for reservations. Again, the pressures that they put on the majority of the group is what minority influence is. Studies suggest that minorities who argue constantly promote the group to reconsider even long held or previously unquestioned assumptions and procedures. So this is the same that happened with child marriage, sati, and stuff like that, right? So minority groups, there was a very small group that came up with things saying that, oh, sati is bad, child marriage is bad, you shouldn't do it. It was the pressure that these people put on the majority of people that actually helped change a long-held belief or the long-held tradition. Minority influence is indirect and instigates innovation and conversions as the members of the majority struggle to validate their judgments. Now, again, coming back to the example of sati and child marriage again. So there is a minority and there's a majority, right? Here, your minority says, no, this is very bad. This is wrong. You're hurting someone's life who's innocent. They have nothing to do with this. The majority of the majority group that was there that said, no, this had to be done, were at loss of words because they did not know how to defend their own argument. Minority influence is said to occur when majority subgroups attempt to change the minority. Example, teachers often influence the students. So here, a teacher influences a student, right? Whatever we are taught by our teachers, their beliefs and their belief structure also crafts our belief structure. Again, I will take the example of B.R. Ambedkar. His original name is B.R. Satpal, Bhim Rao Satpal. But his master, his name is Ambedkar. His surname is Ambedkar. He came up with the entire thing that no, the education will liberate you. Your education will help you. That is how Bhimrao Ambedkar or B.R. Ambedkar came to be the person he is. And yes, I do watch that serial, Ambedkar. No, most of it is from there. So the teacher influences the student to such a stage that he became the person who wrote our constitution. Persuasion, an active attempt. So what is persuasion? It is an active attempt by one person to change another person's attitude, belief, or emotion associated with some issue, person, concept, or object. So say you have a group of friends, and one friend is trying to make sure that you have bad thought about another friend. This person is going to pester you and persuade you and make sure that you change your belief, right? So one lie that the person keeps telling will automatically in your mind register as true after some time. Persuasion, broadly defined as change in attitudes or beliefs based on information received from others, focuses on written or spoken messages sent from the source to the recipient. So here you see these two pictures, right? One says that we in our company, we need to make recycling mandatory. So these people are like, no, bro, we're not going to do it. It is not necessary that and this. But after six meetings, this person was finally able to get through to these people. He says, we really need to make recycling mandatory in our company. And the others are like, okay, fine. He's being so persistent. He's pestering us so much. Just to get him off our back, we'll have to look at this subject. We'll have to take a look into the subject. Persuasion operates on the assumption that individuals process messages carefully whenever they are motivated and are able to do so. So when you're motivated to think badly against a friend of yours by another friend of yours, and if you're able to think badly about this person who the other person is instigating you towards, then you are persuaded. So it is the operation or persuasion operates on the assumption that one individual's process messages carefully whenever they're motivated and are able to do so. Elaboration likelihood model, or the ELM. It is a theory of persuasion postulating that attitude changes occur on a continuum of elaboration and thus under certain conditions may be a result of relatively extensive or relatively little scrutiny of attitude, that is relevant information. See, till recently, there was no understanding, at least for me, there was no understanding how powerful these mantras and all can be. And later on, through someone, I came to know that water has a memory retentive kind of a thing, right? So the molecules of the water respond to the environment around it, takes the form of the environment, right? So a happy environment causes the water to take, the molecules of the water to take a particular form. So someone says, comes from outside and is completely irritated. If the water inside the house is under a happy environment, the minute the person takes this water, drinks this water, they can actually feel that happiness. They can actually feel a lot relaxed. So this persuasion postulating attitude change occurs in a continuum of elaboration. So I did not understand all this till this person has explained it to me, right? the whole reason I'm taking up this example is because I did not understand why something as simple as that can change a person's mood or something like that at that particular minute. So this person's explanation of the structure of the molecules and all that has heavily influenced the way I think, right? Next, we move on to the theory. The next point is that the theory postulates that attitude strength depends on the amount of elaboration on which the attitude is based, and and proposes possible mechanisms by which a variable may influence the persuasion process. So here it talks about the strength or the evidence or the evidence behind your the theory that you're talking about. So I've taken different theories that were there. I could connect this particular theory that water actually holds the takes the form, the molecules of the water take the form of the environment around it, right? So happy takes a happy kind of form and sad takes a sad kind of a form. I have connected it to different types of theories, right? And I've seen that it actually happens. It actually works. I'm not exactly sure if this example is correct or not here, but it does feel to me that it is right. So the theory postulates that attitude strength depends on the amount of elaboration on which the attitude is based and proposed possible mechanisms by which a variable may influence the persuasion process. Heuristic systemic model. It is a theory of persuasion that postulates that the validity of the persuasive message can be assessed in two different ways. The systematic processing involves the careful scrutiny of the merits of attitude, that is the relevant information in the message, and heuristic processing involves the use of a subset of information in the message as a basis of implementing a simple decision rule to determine if the message should be accepted. For example, judging a message to be valid because its source is highly credible. So suppose, say, the RBI sends a message saying that we are not going to ask you for information of your accounts in order to do whatever process it is. It is coming from the RBI directly. So we will judge the validity of the message. Suppose, say, from some random number, it comes that you have won 1 crore rupees. You're not going to believe it because it is not from a credible source. If it comes directly from the RBI, it is a different matter altogether. But there is no chance of that happening. If it comes from a random number, you'll be like, oh, this is scam. This is not something related to us. These people are trying to fool us. So you'll ignore that. Social impact theory, a theory of social influence postulating that the amount of influence exerted by a source on a target depends on the strength of the source compared to that of the target, that is social status of the source versus that of the target. So suppose, say, there's a very small company. Okay, and it says that no, this is the truth behind hacking and all that. Mm-hmm. And there's a larger company that says, a very bigger, much higher company that says, no, we don't track anyone, we don't hack anyone. You're obviously going to believe what the bigger company says, even though what the smaller company says is true. Correct? Okay. The immediacy of the source to the target. So, for example, the physical or psychological distance between them. That means, I'm not exactly sure what it is. If anybody can explain it very well, please go ahead. The number of sources and targets. Guys, anybody willing to explain? Hello.
Well, it's commonplace, right? If you're reading a false news in all the newspapers, then you will tend to believe it.
Thank you so much, Prakash. Finally, someone's actually active. The impact of the source on the target increases as the source's strength, immediacy, and the number increase relatively to the target. So if the strength of the source increases or the immediacy of the source increases and the number of articles increases, then obviously you're going to believe it rather than what the target company says. For example, say the company ABC is much more bigger than the company XYZ, and there's a feud or a merger going on between these two. And in order for the merger to happen, ABC releases certain news on the company XYZ in order to make it smaller and more easier to approach or buy or something like that. So whatever the information ABC gives on XYZ is going to be more trustworthy, because at least whatever lies they say are going to be more trusted and accepted because the source of ABC is much more higher, right? The strength of the company ABC is much more higher than that of your XYZ. Then before XYZ can even go to the press and tell them that this is what is happening, ABC has already formulated a plan, released the news even before the entire thing happens, and made sure that the XYZ cannot go to the press before they can. So their news comes first, and that is what we believe. The number of sources. Again, suppose say ABC has a channel of its own. ABC has a news channel of its own, has a social media channel of its own, a YouTube channel of its own. It's going to start releasing the information from different sources. So it is all going to come to you at the same time. So you're going to believe this person, this company, more than you're going to believe XYZ, because it doesn't have as much as information or a channel to give it to you as much as ABC. The impact of the source on target increases as the source's strength, immediacy, and number increase relatively to the target. Social impact means any of the number of changes that might occur in an individual, that is physiological, cognitive, emotional, or behavioral, due to the presence of another person or action of another person who may be either real or implied. That is real, imagined, or thought about, implied, right? Social impact theory proposes that the impact of any information source is a function of three factors: the number of others who make up the sources, the immediacy, that is the closeness and their strength, and the salience of their power. Social influence network theory. The formal theory involves a two-weighted averaging of influential opinions. At each stage, actors form a norm opinion or a normal opinion, which is weighted average, which is a weighted average of the others' opinions in the group. This theory utilizes mathematical models and quantification to measure the process of social influence. Expectations state theory, or expectation states theory, a sociological explanation of status differentiations, groups processing that group members allocate status not only to those who possess qualities suggesting competence at a task, but also to those who have qualities that the members mistakenly think are indicators of competence and potential, such as sex, age, wealth, and ethnicity. So suppose it is an American, I'm not going to say American, but anywhere, a person who is white, a person who is black, a person who is brown, and a person who is, Okay, these three are your major categories, right? So let's say that the person who is white is a male who is of an average age. He is decent, he has decent experience and he has decent wealth as well. The black person is a female who is really, really young. And the last person is, okay, this young person is not as wealthy. And you say that there's a brown person who is really old and is extremely wealthy. Who are you going to believe? Who are you going to, okay, which person's words are going to influence you more depends on what you see and what you believe. So for us, if mostly, this is general, this one, a person who is white says something, you tend to believe it more. A person who is black says it, I know this is all sexist and, all this, as you can say, sexist, racist and everything. But these are examples that you can notice generally that are happening around the world. So a black person says something, you'll not really believe it. A brown person says it, you'll think it's nonsense. General stuff. Areas of social influence. Three areas of social influence are conformity, compliance, and obedience. Conformity. Conformity is the adjustment of one's opinion, judgment, or actions so that they become more consistent with the opinions, judgment, or actions of other people, normative standards of social group of situation. Conformity includes temporary outward acquiescences as well as more enduring private acceptances. Conformity is the process by which an individual's attitude, beliefs, and behavior are conditioned by what is conceived to be what the other person might perceive. Any doubts so far? Anything I can explain?
No.
All understood?
Yes.
Thank you, Praharshi. The only one who's awake. The influence occurs in both small groups as well as society as a whole. And it may be the result of a subtle unconscious influence, which is either direct or an overt social pressure. For example, people tend to follow the norms of a society when eating and watching television, even when they are at home by themselves. So there's the norm says that you'll have to eat with a spoon. Certain foods can be eaten with a spoon. Certain foods can be eaten with hand. Certain foods can be eaten with a fork. So you generally tend to stick to these particular types of norms while eating, even when you're at home. So you generally don't tend to eat noodles with a fork. You can't eat rice with, you generally tend to eat noodles with a fork. You cannot eat rice with a fork. And you can definitely not eat dosa with a fork, right? It is really difficult to do so. But you eat rice with a spoon and dosa with your hand. So there are certain norms that the society has set the way you eat. And when you're eating at home, you're generally sitting on the floor and eating or at the dining table. And the way you dress when you're eating is also different. People often conform from a desire to achieve a sense of security within a group. Typically a group that is similar in age, culture, religion, or education status. So if you take your group of friends that are around you, they're generally of your same age, the same background and educational status, right? I wouldn't consider religion because I have friends from all religions. And most of us do. We have friends from almost every religion that is there. Okay? But cultures are different. Your culture also, you tend to stick with people from the same cultural background because it is easy to communicate with them. And education status also. You generally do not tend to befriend someone who is of a, multi-PhD level because a person is generally intimidated with someone of a higher educational background and thinks low of a person from a lower educational background. So someone of 10th standard comes and say, a person who's passed out of 10th standard and is the same age, you generally do not want to talk to them or do not want to befriend them because their educational level, it is not only educational level, it is the maturity that the education brings to them. That all influences how you behave with the person who is of the same age but of a different educational level. Okay. Ash's experiment on conformity. It is the most influential study of conformity when that came from Solomon E. Ash. Now, this particular experiment is of, it has just two cards in it. One card has a particular line drawn on it, which is of a certain length. And the other card has three different lines, out of which only one line is the is of the similar height or the length of the line drawn in card one. Now, a group of 9 or 10 people were asked to come and sit and find out which line was the same. Amongst the group, these people put in other people who had opinions of their own or whose opinions were those of the experimenter, because these are the people who were put in there to confuse these people. And it was seen that the answers were generally opinionated towards either conformity or people who are very fickle and tend to follow others. A person, the adjustments of one's opinions, judgments, or actions so that they become more consistent. They become more consistent with, okay, I think I've got this wrong. Okay, conformity, sorry, before we go ahead, what is conformity? Again, I'm explaining what conformity is. Conformity is the adjustment of one's opinion, judgment, or action so that they become more consistent with the opinions, judgments, and action of other people and normative standards of social group, right? Conformity includes, I've already done this, sorry, the factors that increase conformity. So now the attractiveness of the members in the group definitely influences how you're going to answer. So suppose, say, Praharsh is sitting in that group and this extremely beautiful woman walks in and she says that the line C is the same as line the line in the first card. He'll generally tend to agree with it because he's more attracted to this woman now. Example, not serious again. Complexity or difficulty of the task. So the way the difficulty levels of this task also influence your conformity. So the easier the task is, the more confident you are in your answer, right? So the more you're more confirmed with your answer. But if the complexity or the difficulty of the task increases, your complexity tends to waver. Sorry, your conformity tends to waver. Group cohesiveness. So in that particular group of people, no, there are all these people who are put in by the experimenter who say, no, this is the correct answer. That is because majority of the group is of these people. And they're testing they're testing the minority who are not set by the experimenter. So the group says these six people who are there on the experimenter's behalf say that the line A is equal to line in the first card. So the group's cohesiveness, they're influencing the person's mind and saying to think that the first line in the second card is equivalent to the line on the first card. I know I've confused everyone. If I have, please say yes. Guys, it's fine.
No, it's fine.
Anybody else apart from Paraharsh? I know he's awake. Fine, I understand. Informational social influence. Informational social influence occurs when one turns to the numbers of one's group to obtain accurate information. a person is most likely to use informational influence in three particular situations. In the time of ambiguity, where a person becomes uncertain about what to do, and they are likely to depend on others for the answers. Second one is during a crisis, when immediate action is necessary, and in spite of panic, right? Immediate actions are required in spite of the panic. Suppose there's a building on fire, you need immediate actions. In spite of you being worried, you cannot start panicking, right? You'll have to make sure that someone, you are safe and the people around you are safe. Looking at other people can help ease fears, but unfortunately, they are not always right. Okay. So what happens is, suppose you're flying, right? You're in a flight and there's a heavy turbulence and you're dropping drastically. You look at other people and some people know that it's just an air pocket. You yourself know it's an air pocket, but the fear of falling is causing panic in you. Suppose, say, the guy beside you is like, no, this is chill. I've been through this before. This area, it is common. And it'll be gone in a minute or so. And you'll be like, okay, fine. This person seems calm enough. The person is very reassuring. He looks very reassuring. So I'll look at him. But it might not always be right, right? It might not always be correct that the flight that you're traveling in has gone through the first air pocket and you're falling. But the person who's thinking that, no, this is going to get over might not always be right. Or it may be the other way around. The other way around will be like, oh my God, no, this flight is going to fall to its, fall to pieces. But no, it is not always right, right? It may be that it is just a small air pocket. It is going to pass through and it's going to be very convenient. These are the different opinions that you see when you're looking at people around you. More knowledgeable a person is, the more valuable they are as a resource. So you're in the flight that is falling during a turbulence and the pilot comes online and says, chill bro, the flight is going to be okay. It's a very small turbulence. Okay. It might be a big turbulence, but it is for a very short time. We'll be able to manage control of the flight very soon. It is very reassuring because this person is more knowledgeable than the person sitting beside you or yourself, because he has more experience about the air pressures, the airways, and the flight itself, right? Every person perceived different amounts of movement. Okay, when over time, the same estimate was agreed on and others confirmed to it. Next topic is your normative social influence. Normative social influence occurs when one confirms to be liked or accepted by the numbers of the groups. It usually results in the public compliance, doing or saying something without believing in it. He exposed people in a group. A series of lines. Okay, this particular experimenter exposed a number of people in a group to a series of lines, and the participants were asked to match one line with a standard line. Normative influence is a function of social impact theory, which has three components. The number of people in the group has a surprising effect. Immediacy is how close the group is in the time and space when the influence takes place. I'm sorry, I seem to have missed a few sentences in between. I will bring this back. I will correct this and I'll send it to you, okay? Minorities, influence and conformity. Conformity generally leads individuals. Conformity generally leads individuals who are occasionally able to reverse this tendency and change the people around them. This is known as minority influence, a special case of informational influence or informational power. If the minority fluctuates and shows uncertainty case or shows a case of uncertainty, it will increase the probability of changing the beliefs and behaviors of the majority. Majority numbers who are perceived as experts are high in status or have benefited the group in the past are also more likely to succeed. Now, your gender and conformity. Societal norms are often established, often established gender differences. There are differences in the way men and women conform to social influences. It was found that women are more persuasible and more conforming than men in group pressure situations that involve surveillance. Normative social influence explains women's attempts to create the ideal body through dieting and also by eating disorders such as anorexia nervosa and bulimia. Men, in contrast, are likely to pursue their ideal body image through dieting, steroids, and overworking their bodies rather than developing an eating disorder. Compliance. What is compliance? Compliance is the submission to the demands, wishes, and suggestions of others. A change in a person's behavior is in response to a direct request. A variety of techniques have been developed to enhance the compliance with requests. Although some techniques have been developed to enhance compliance by producing attitude change, behavior change is a primary goal of these techniques. Compliance refers to the act of responding favorably to an explicit or an implicit request offered by others. The request may be explicit, such as an advertisement promoting its products without directly asking the people to purchase it. Principles observed by Robert Cialdini. These include your reciprocity, your credibility, liking, friendship, liking or friendship, scarcity, social validation, and commitment. Reciprocity, it means, it is based on the social norm that treat others as you would expect to be treated. When someone does you a favor, it creates an obligation to accept any reasonable request he or she might make in turn. We feel a motivation to reciprocate. A guilt arousal produces an increase in compliance. So when you're guilty that someone's done something for you and you're not able to do it, it is what guides you or motivates you to help this person back. Credibility, it is the source of request. Credibility is the source of request that will also affect whether we comply or not. It is a source. If the source is an expert with knowledgeable If the source is an expert with knowledge, abilities, or skills, that is, would be more likely to comply. That means if the person that is giving you the information has more knowledge, is more able, and is more skilled, then the person who's listening to it will be more motivated to comply to what this person says. This principle is used as a marketing strategy where they put on a white lab coat which form a consumer's point of which from a consumer's point of view will symbolize authority. So a lab coat, imagine your advertisements of soap or detergents or something like that. This random person walks in front of you. You know he's an actor from a different movie or a different TV series or something. And this person says, no, use this cream. It will be very good for your skin. The white lab coat compels you to think that this particular item is of excellent quality because it symbolizes authority, right? Liking and friendship. A social exchange theory states that human relationships are formed by using a subjective cost-benefit analysis and the comparison of alternatives. Thus, complying with the person we like certainly is more favorable. This particular principle is used by salesmen all over the world. For example, the principle of liking is common with a neighborhood, neighbors selling and buying things from each other. So if you're in a community, one of your best friends is in the community is selling sanitizers during this COVID season. You're compelled to buy from them because you like this person and he is also your neighbor and also a close friend of yours. But if some random person in the community is selling and you do not know them at all, you would be like, why would I buy from them? The more trusting of the person, the more obliged you are to buy. Suppose, say, I tell I've opened a bakery business. The bakery is right in the heart of the city. It is a very established place. You as my friends are compelled to come and buy from me, right? Because I'm a person you trust and you'll come and buy from me. That is what liking and friendship is. Scarcity. The scarcity effect refers to the influence of perceived scarcity on the subjective desirability of an object. Okay, so suppose I say that I've only made like 5 cakes. Whoever wants it can come and take it. And 20 minutes later, I'll be like, there's only one cake available or one item available of what I've made. So how many of you will be like, oh my God, this thing has sold out quickly, like within 20 minutes, there's only one cake left. I should go get it. You will come running and then take it and buy it, right? That is what it means. Now, I remember there was this one particular shop that was kept on the side of the road while I was traveling from home to work and all that, which said the cleaning supplies, which talked about cleaning supplies. And remember, this was there for over a year. I've seen this all throughout the year. They would say this is the last of the season. It's been sold out and this is the last stock. All throughout the year, I've seen it. Remember that. So they've tried to attract people by saying that this particular item is being sold so fast that it is the last of the stock. Okay, it is a gimmick that these people play in order to make the item more attractive to you. When it is seen that an object is limited, we feel the urge to buy them in order to not be left out. It was found that rating of liking, attractiveness, and cost paid were sufficiently higher in the scarcity condition. Suppose, say, I make 20 cakes and each is what, 300 rupees? And by the end of the entire stock, I will say that the cake has gone up to 500 rupees or 1000 even. Person who was buying it at that point of time would have heard so much about it or seen such a beautiful cake. And he likes that cake, he wants it. He will come and buy it no matter if I say 1000 rupees or 10,000 rupees. If he likes it, he will buy it. And just to feel not left out because 20 other people have bought it, he will come and buy it. This is what scarcity is. Social validation, it is also called the principle of conformity and consensus. In compliance, it is a phenomenon in which a person or people are more willing to take a recommended step if they see evidence that many others, especially similar others, are taking it. So suppose, say, schemes, gold schemes, right? There almost every gold shop has these schemes saying that if you pay for 12 months or something, you get a gift from them and all that, and you can buy whatever item that you want. There are different ranges of in every gold shop, right? So 20 other people, 20 or 50 other people of your friends, among your friends are doing this. It has been validated by them saying that it is an awesome scheme. We've been doing this for 5 years or something. You will definitely start taking that step saying that, oh, okay, fine. It is a nice step. It is an amazing way to save money as well as buy an item for my wife or my spouse or my kids or something. So you will step in and take it because you're saving money that way. And also making sure that at the end of the year, you're getting something out of it, right? Human needs to fit in. Okay, the human need to fit in is extremely strong and tends to make us comply in order to be a part of this majority. So suppose say I'm already saving 1 lakh a month or something. Example, not really. Example, I'm saying saving 1 lakh a month. For me, something that is going to cost around 20,000 is not going to be much of a saving after that 1 lakh, right? But yet, my desire to fit in with the rest of the people will obviously make me want to do it. It is going to save me a further extra 20,000, but doesn't really have to be, right? I just want to be amongst the majority. And that is why I do it. Commitment to a store or a company induced by loyalty cards or bonuses can make it harder for a person to change where they shop or what they purchase. Like, okay, suppose say example, my bakery itself. Suppose say I give you loyalty cards and bonuses and say that after 10 purchases, you get this chocolate box free. After 15 purchases, I'll give you donuts free. I'll give you cookies free. Stuff like that, which I make as offers, will keep attracting you people saying that, oh, this person is going to give us this free, right? And again, I'll say conditions apply. That is a different thing altogether. So I keep you committed to my bakery all the time, my company and my branches all the time, and make sure that you do not go to another place. Things like all these shopping, clothing companies do, things like Marks and Spencers, your Pantaloons, Reliance, all these people have done this, right? They've introduced loyalty cards or bonuses and they've made you come back for more. They give you bonuses. They'll say that, see, sir, you bought 5,000 rupees worth of clothes. We're giving you 2,000 rupees as a bonus. You can come and shop next time. They won't let you. It is not allowed to be done on the same day. Suppose you're buying for 5,000 and you're like, no, I'll bill. The next bill is that same day within an hour. They won't let you do that, but you'll have to come back another day for that particular amount. Confinement to a mental institution by court or by court order following certification by appropriate mental health authorities. Is this the process? Okay, this process may be voluntary, but it is generally involuntary. So commitment is the, suppose say there's a mental person in someone's family. This person is put into an asylum because he's either the threat to himself or threat to another person. It is generally involuntary, right? He doesn't want to go there because he knows he's going to be confined. This again is commitment, right? You're committing this person to an asylum. Obligation or devotion to a person, relationship, task, cause, or other entity or action. So you've taken up psychology. Now, why you've taken up psychology? Because it is an obligation that you want to do for the society. It is a task that you want to do. It is a cause that you've taken up. So this is all, again, example, right? Suppose you say you wanted to help these poor people who have mental health conditions. That is a cause that you've taken up. That is an action that you've taken up and you're obliged. You have an obligation to do so, or you're devoting yourself for helping these people. It is a part of commitment, right? Again, marriage is a commitment. Your relationship is a commitment. A task is a commitment. And that brings us to the end of the chapter. So all of you, thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, finally, someone's awake.
Where's my free cookies and
wait, first stop recording, no?